Happy Easter to you. I'm going to ask you to stand, if you would, right now, and let's sing about this risen Savior. Hymn 357. Sing with us, please.
Thank you. You may be seated. What a joy it is to see each and every one of you here this morning. It's a beautiful day that God's made. He made it for you and I, that we might be able to come together to worship today. We are glad to see each and every one of you. And I want you to feel welcome here today. We love you. We appreciate you coming and being a part of our service today. Let's bow our heads together for prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of being able to gather here on Easter Sunday. Lord, we thank you that you suffered, you bled, you died, and you came out of that grave to make intercession for your people, to save our souls and give us eternal life. Lord, where we would be today without you? What would we be today, Lord, if it wasn't for the wonderful grace of God? And Lord, I thank you for every person that's here today. And Lord, I pray for the richest blessings of God to be bestowed upon every person that's gathered here today. And Lord, if there's even one person here that's never made you the Lord and Master of their life, may they do so today. Father, I pray for the men and women who serve in our military around the world today. Bless them, Father. Protect their families and care for them. For our missionaries, wherever they are in the world today, Lord, would you bless them? And Father, I do pray for our choir, our musicians today, and ask you to bless Brother Keith as he leads our music. Lord, would you accept our praises today? And all this we ask in the wonderful name of Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Brother Keith.
Well, happy Easter to y'all. Didn't get a chance to say that a few minutes ago. I'm glad to see y'all here too. I was telling the choir just a few minutes ago, Palm Sunday is a very special Sunday to me, and it is a special Sunday in the Christian faith, but that's just the beginning of the story, isn't it? But then it comes to today. And the good news is, this is not the end of the story. Is that right? This is just the best part. Let's sing about that best part right now. Hymn 368, He Lives. Let's sing these three verses together.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always there. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me alone.
Remain standing and turn around and shake hands with someone.
Shepherd cries, another spotless lamb has died. Oh, how could just one sacrifice our God Jehovah satisfy?
Yeah.
Church, we got a lot to be thankful for, don't we? With that holy Lamb that gave his life, took our sins upon himself, and died on that cross that day. But glory, glory, Easter came, didn't it? He arose again. Let's sing our offertory hymn together this morning, hymn 361. Now, this tune's going to be familiar to you. We sing it at Christmas with the words, Angels of the Realms of Glory. It's the same melody, but Easter words to it. Worship Christ, the risen King. Stand with us. Let's sing verses 1, 2, 4, and 5. Get ready to hear the word of God spoken, broken open before us. Let's just sing this little chorus together. Remain seated right where you are. And if you need it, hymn 358, Because He Lives, just the chorus this morning.
In sleeplessness and rose at every sound, half in hopeless sorrow, half in fear of the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. It was just before the sunrise when I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle and a voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. But there was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said they moved him in the night, and none of us knows where. Oh, the stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. So we both ran toward the garden, and John ran on ahead. And we found the stone and empty tomb just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they'd wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Something strange had happened here, just what I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, 'cause I'd seen them crucify him, and then I saw him die. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. So even if he was alive, it would never be the same. But suddenly, the air was filled with a strange and sweet perfume. Light shone out from everywhere, casting shadows from the room. And Jesus stood before me with his arms spread open wide. And I fell down to my knees, and I clung to him and cried. Oh, but he raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt and my confusion disappeared in sweet release. Oh, and every fear I ever had just melted into peace. Sweet! Stand with me this morning and declare it. Hallelujah! Sing with me. He's alive, please. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive. I'm alive, 'cause he's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open.
And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Whew, we could go home now. Praise the Lord. He is alive. And how do we know he's alive? Because he's right here. Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, you want to follow them in the scripture reading, turn to Mark's Gospel, the 16th chapter, and let's begin with the first verse. The things that I want us to see, he is risen. The three greatest words in the Bible. And when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, James and Salome, had brought sweet spices that they may come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came into the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And they said among themselves, "Who shall roll us away the stone for the door of the sepulchre?" And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side and clothed in a long white garment. And they were afraid. And he said unto them, Be not afraid. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. May God add his blessing to the reading of his word. May we pray together. Our Heavenly Father, if it please you this morning, would you permit us to share this message with our people? Lord, may the Holy Spirit have absolute charge here of everything that we do and say. In Jesus' name, amen. Three of the greatest words in the Bible are the three words, He is risen. What marks Christianity from all the religions of the world is that we have a resurrected, a living Savior this morning. He's not stone, he's not wood, but he's a living being that sits at the right hand of God to make intercession for you and for me. Those words that mainly indicate that he finished the will of the Father in regards to the cross. Jesus was no doubt that preordained Lamb of God. And we see also, and we need to look at the various forms that it was given. John used words in John 21 and verse 14. He spoke of Jesus showing himself to the disciples. He said after that, he was risen from the dead. Also, the angelic visitors proclaimed that he was had arose. The angels announced his birth and his resurrection. Several of the women were going to bring spices early in the morning to the two angelic beings showed up at the empty tomb. And the two suddenly appeared to the women and said unto them, Why ye seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee. Then Peter preached at Pentecost. Acts 2:32 said, This Jesus hath God raised up, whereon we all are witnesses. And Peter told them that he and others could testify that they had seen Jesus. Folks, if Jesus is not alive today, our faith is in vain. There would not be any reason for you and I to gather here this morning on Easter Sunday. But folks, we need this morning to understand and to realize that he is alive. He is well. And you and I can worship him. We see also that Paul said that it is a part of the gospel message. In 1 Corinthians 15 and 4, Paul proclaimed all that he was, and he was buried, and that he arose again the third day according to the scriptures. Jesus said that he would arise. John 2:19, Jesus answered and said unto them, Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll raise it up. Folks, he was not talking about a building constructed of stone and mortar, but his body. And let us think for just a few moments this morning about those words, He is risen. What do they say to me and what do they say to you as God chosen and redeemed people? There are several things that we can think about this morning that can convey by these words. They're words of observation, first of all. Those who spoke these words knew that the resurrection was not a superstition. It was a wishful thinking on the part of men. They knew it had actually happened. They knew it was a reality. The angels had seen Christ come forth. The disciples had seen an undisturbed grave closed through which Jesus passed. Also, the disciples saw him in the upper room after the resurrection. And folks, I'm glad that there were many eyes to witness the fact that he is risen. All throughout the Word of God, God has provided eyewitnesses. Then Paul spoke of the 500 in 1 Corinthians 15 that saw Jesus together at one time after he had came forth from the dead, and that he would hold up in any court. We see also those words are words of declaration. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says, Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, which also ye have received and wherein you stand. If Christ is not alive, I need to quit and get out of this pulpit. If Christ is not risen, you and I need to leave here because it would be a lie. But we don't have to do that, folks, because He's alive. He's alive. How do I know? He's been here this morning. I don't know about you, but I felt Him. He spoke to my heart and my life today, and I hope He has you. He's alive. He's alive. Then we see also, Paul said, I found in my personal experience that He is risen. Isn't that wonderful? That you and I can experience Jesus as an individual today. He's risen. Because He saved my soul a long time ago and established my going in Jesus. Then we see also, when did Paul discover such a truth? He found out on the road to Damascus in Acts 22. He appeared unto him as a great light and a voice unto the religious Paul. Paul thought that he was going about with letters from the church to destroy Christians. He thought he was doing right. Till Jesus struck him down on the road to Damascus. And He spoke to him. He said, I don't want you destroying people anymore. I want you to tell them about Jesus. And folks, that's what we need to be busy doing today. These words, He is risen, as words of aggravation. The words that of Jesus' resurrection made the authorities and the religious upset and angry. They didn't want Him nor expect Him to rise from the dead. To believe that He is risen are words of edification and elation rather than words of aggravation. Folks, we love to hear the old stories that never grow weary and never grow tired of the story of Jesus. Oh, we can read the Word of God over and over and over, and it's just as fresh the second time, 100 times as it was the first. It's not like a magazine or a newspaper, but the Word of God is so fresh and so real. Then there were words of affection. The angelic beings in Mark 16:7 told Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome to go tell the disciples and tell Peter that Jesus had risen. Why did the angels single out Peter to be told? There is at least a twofold reason. First, to bring comfort to Peter's heart because he had fallen and he had denied that he even knew Jesus. Remember the story? Before the rooster would crow 3 times, Jesus told him, he said, you will deny me. And then to encourage him to meet Christ and the rest of the disciples even though he had denied Christ. To let Peter know that Christ's love is eternal. And if you're sitting here today, folks, it doesn't matter what you've done or how bad you think you've been, Jesus Christ's blood is there to wash you clean and make a new person out of you. If you'll only confess Him, Lord and Savior of your life. Then we see also, they are the words of a foundation this morning. Christianity rises and falls on the resurrection of Christ. A dead Savior cannot save. And thus our message is what it claims to be. Then it is a foundational truth that Lord Jesus has bodily arose from the grave. Anyone who denies or tries to explain it away, the resurrection of Jesus is, that person's an unbeliever. It is under the guillotine of divine wrath. Today's Easter. We have hope. But folks, there's coming a day that there's not going to be any hope. When Jesus comes for His church, it's all going to be over. I'll make it, preacher. No, I don't know where you will or not. Because the Word of God says, He's going to come in a moment, in a blink of an eye. You ever think about how fast your eyes blink? That's just how fast Jesus is going to be on the scene. You're not going to have an opportunity to get ready. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of salvation because He is risen. Amen. He's alive. And These are words of resurrection. Jesus said in John 14, 19, because I live, ye shall live also. The resurrection of every believer is guaranteed because who we're putting our faith in, our life is in Him. And if the grave could not hold Him down, folks, it could not hold us when the time comes. Jesus is going to call us all out if we're already passed on. And folks, what a day that's going to be. Can you imagine being in the cemetery when Jesus comes? All those graves opening up and all those people coming out who have trusted Jesus through the years and through the centuries. What a day it's going to be, folks, to meet family and friends and people that we love that have gone on ahead of us. What a day it's going to be. And it can be that because He is risen. And these are words of stimulation. To stimulate means to rouse to action an effort by encouragement or pressure. It means to spur on, to entice. If nothing else this morning, folks, should make us want to serve God better, it's Easter. He is risen.
Amen.
He is risen. Three little short words. It makes all the difference in the world. It rouses me to live for Christ. There's no better life than the Christian life. And I'd tell anybody that. I've been serving God since I was about in 1963, ever how long that's been, almost all my life. And folks, I'm telling you, I wouldn't trade it for anything in this world. I've had my ups and I've had my downs and the devil's attacked. But let me tell you, folks, nothing's like serving God. Nothing is like serving Jesus. And we need to do that. Then we see also, it rouses me to trust Christ. There are a lot of things about the Scriptures I don't understand, but I'm going to trust Him. I've trusted Him with my salvation. I've trusted Him with my family and my life. And folks, I believe that He's going to carry me all the way through.
Amen.
Amen. He's there for us, and He promised it to be. We see also, since He arose from the grave, I can trust Him not only to forgive me and save me, provide for me, but one day to resurrect this old vile body out of the grave, and I'll have a glorified body. One that does not know any sickness, no disease, no sin, because we're going to be with Jesus. He makes the difference because He is risen. How blessed and how wonderful to be a child of God are the words, He is risen. When you leave here today, keep that in the back of your mind. Keep that in your heart all next week. He's not dead, but He's alive. He has risen. With every eye closed, every head bowed, every Christian praying. If you know this morning that you're going to heaven when you leave this world, will you pray for that person sitting beside you or near you that might be struggling? Just trust God with it. Will you let God speak to your heart? Whatever your need is today, would you come down here and let me help you? These altars are open. These front rows are open. And you just come. You don't have to say a word to me. I'm here if you want help. I'll pray with you. I'll encourage you. I promise I'll never embarrass you. Just want to show you Jesus. Will you come in a moment? Our Heavenly Father, would you take this invitation now, Lord, and use it? Will you use it for your honor and your glory? And Lord, I pray that not one person will leave this place today unprepared to meet you. But that, Lord, when we walk out that door today, that we all know Jesus as Lord and Savior because you're alive. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. May we stand together.
I hear the Savior say,